Good morning to everybody. Plan A was for you to have paper copy of all of the material that that I'm going to be talking about, and that didn't happen, so we're going to Plan B. And Plan B is I'm going to run through a lot of slides here, and I'm going to talk about the slides. I'm not going to make the presentation. And the idea being that what I want to try to do is tell you how I've done things and how I've thought about some things, and things that I like and don't like about what it is I've done personally. And above all, I'd like all of you to think very hard about these issues, as many of you already have. And when you upgrade things that I may show you here, I hope that you'd be kind enough to share those things with me over time. Training the trainers is indeed a challenge. Can we have the first slide, please? That's what we're trying to do. It's really aiming to help you at public speaking, and so I suppose the first thing I should say is, unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, at any rate, let me run through a lot of things. In any slide presentation, you ought to tell people what you're going to tell them, then tell them in detail, and then tell them what you told them. Peak oil is an extremely complicated issue, as you all know, and how you get this across to people is not easy at all. And then, as Debbie says, once you get it across to a lot of people, they ask what it is they should do with it. And, of course, the answer to that is get moving, get more people to pay attention, and so forth. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly run through slides from two different presentations and then a few slides on the positive side of things, and I'm going to comment on these things. I'm not going to go through the substance of what's involved there. Okay, this was a presentation I gave to the Global Futures Forum a while back. First thing, as I just said, is tell people what you're going to tell them, and we're not going to go into that here. One of the most important things in all of this business in getting across to people is to get them to understand that oil reserves are kind of like inventory in business or cans of soup on the shelf at home and so forth, but it's not the same. They're kind of similar but not the same. In this area here are boxes on inventory. You could take them off out as fast as you can manage. There's liquid in a bucket. You can take it out as fast as you can manage, but oil fields don't give you that kind of flexibility. At point they peak and then they go into decline, and when they go into decline, of course, you're into a different situation than you are in inventory. I like to talk about numbers, and a good round number here is 10 billion barrels of oil reserves. At best, gives you 1 million barrels a day, and you need to put that into perspective. That's a little over 1% of what we use in the world today. Little numbers are also important, and this gets into issues associated with small changes in oil availability, in fact, can lead to recession and other problems. Okay, one of the things that I like to do, and I think it helps audience, is to kind of show people where you are in what it is you're going to be talking about, and so you'll see slides like this in my presentations. One of the most important things in all of this business is to get across that peaking is inevitable. It happens in oil fields, a couple of different shapes there, countries, and then it's going to happen in the world. Maybe there's better data than indicated here by the Royal Swedish Academy from a number of years ago, but it makes the point that a whole lot of countries that have been oil producers are at or past their peak, and since this 2005 study was done, more have gone into decline. But it's a matter of getting the message out to people that this happens, it's happening, and it's continuing to happen, and the world is not far behind. This is an important slide from many points of view from my standpoint, and that is that it basically shows that oil production rose until mid-2004, and then it fluctuated. And as any of you know, or most of you know, maybe all of you know, the data fluctuates, and therefore it's very hard to find a trend, and that's an important point here. The shadowed area here encompasses the fluctuation range that we've been dealing with, and in roughly 5%, in fact, covers where we've been since mid-2004. But again, there's a message to get across there. It's also important to get across to people that, in fact, because so many fields are in decline around the world, to just stay steady, you have to bring more and more oil production online each year. And this gets at that. It gets at the decline rate estimates by Cambridge Energy Research Associates and others, and one can play with this for a while. But the point to get across to people is that you've got to run like hell just to stay steady. And this translates that to numbers in terms of barrels of oil a day. If you want to expand from just staying steady, which is what a number of people hope to have happen, then you have to add even more barrels, and that means that, using some folks' numbers, you're going to be talking about multiple Saudi Arabias in order to be able to do that. And really, that's silly, because oil people are not stupid. They're smart people, and if the oil is out there and there are that many Saudi Arabias out there, there's just simply no chance in God's green earth that they missed them. Okay, this gets at the issue, and I'll talk about this a little bit more, and that is that the recent recession has caused considerable cutback in investment, and so we are likely to have an investment, a near-term investment-related oil production shortages in the world. Again, tell people where you are in going through your various topics. This is maybe a little bit out of date. It's capable of being updated, of course. And the idea here is there's a whole lot of very significant organizations and people that have said we've got trouble, and the trouble may be now or it's very soon. And also there are people on the other side of the issue. And I think it's important and to be balanced and tell folks that there's people on both sides. Some examples that I use of forecasts of maximum world production based on three different studies. There are more than this, but the idea is to get across to people that a number of folks are thinking generally very similarly. One of the big things, of course, is giant oil fields that are that provide 50 to 60% of world oil production, and this basically gets across that the number of fields that have been found over a decade period and the amount of oil has been dropping dramatically. Again, it gets across the point that you got to find it, as Colin Campbell says, you got to find it first before you can produce it, and we're not finding it, but we're using more and more. Okay, again, back to the point of where you are, talking about mitigation. This is just a matter of talking briefly about the fact that we get a whole lot out of oil that is not often the subject of ASPO discussions and so forth, but a lot of these things are extremely important to human life. And on the other hand, most of what we talk about in ASPO and on these issues is related to fuels. So this just says we're going to talk about transportation fuels. Here is our attempt at trying to show that you've got these enormous fleets of light-duty vehicles out there, and you add some each year and you subtract some each year, but it's going to take a long time to change this fleet over, let alone it being very expensive. And as we learned from the recent recession, of course, you're not going to sell 17 million vehicles per year in the United States as you did before, because when you get into a recession, a whole lot of things aren't going to happen, of course. Mitigation options, these are the physical options, and on top I've added conservation, which I define as doing without, and rationing, which is something the government would do. And it makes the point that oil is energy, but energy is not oil. In other words, nuclear power and wind and so forth is not going to do anything for those existing airplanes and trucks and so forth that don't run on liquid fuels. You've got to have liquid fuels, and you can't scrap all of that $50 to $100 trillion worldwide of equipment that runs on liquid fuels. This just is a quick way of running through what you can get out of the various options. This is probably for specialized audiences. Same thing here, what you can get out of these different options. And as you see, it's not everything. Then we talk about mitigation, go back to our 2005 study, and these are the physical mitigation options that we looked at that point. And again, the important point here is these things don't do any good unless you build them. So it's an issue of implementation and deployment. This is the picture that we drew back then in our simplified, linearized approach to things, and it shows that there's a lag no matter what you do, because it takes time to build the stuff that's either going to save or going to produce alternate liquids for you. So it takes a long time. So you really want to be ahead of the problem, and as it's turning out, we're not. This takes 5% decline rate after peak and says mitigation, which is delayed, number one, and then takes time to build up. In fact, is you're in a situation where the problem is going to run away from you for a long time. This gets at something that Jim Schlesinger is a friend, and he was the first Secretary of Energy in the United States, and we happened to go back and forth on this, and he just made a comment and said, yes, we all wish that Hirsch is wrong, but he probably isn't. Topics again, looking at how GDP may follow, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a little bit. Oil is essential for world growth. When there's not enough there and we go into decline, there's going to be shortages. Shortages are going to drag down world GDP, and this is an approximation for how that might look. We're also, as I indicated earlier, we're talking about investment, and investment means bringing new oil production online, and investment has been lagging, and particularly with the recession, we've got a problem. So we may be talking about two different phenomena here, an investment-related phenomena and a geological phenomena. I think it's useful to talk about production and exports. This is the UK example, and it basically said things were terrific there for a while, and they were indeed significant exporters, and that was all good. But when they went into decline, and some people in the UK, and I don't understand this, still deny this, you go from not only being an exporter, you become an importer. And that's an important point to develop. Kind of my view of the world here is we're on a plateau now, world liquids production. Oil prices jumped way up, and then we had this unfortunate event and so forth. There's going to be something like 2 to 5 years, and then things are going to go crazy, and it's not going to be good. You can express that in a number of different ways. Again, tell them what you're going to tell them and then tell them what you told them. This is takeaway points for the audience that I was speaking to. Okay, let me jump to something else which is done in PowerPoint, but is really not meant for presentation. And I can make some negative comments on a number of my slides here, because my purpose in doing this next round of things was to have a handout or a mail out so people could take a look at something and not necessarily need the words that went with it. So in a lot of these slides, there's way too many words on it. I think that PowerPoint slides are very helpful because they help people to follow along. But if you've got too many words on a slide, I think you lose people and it becomes too hard to coordinate what you're reading to what you're hearing. So a bunch of these slides will have way too many words on them. All right, again, an overview of what's involved. You'll get this paper copy later so you can see these things. The point here is the tracking of world oil increases with world GDP, and it shows that there's a close correlation. This goes back to 1973 and 1979, which were the two shortage events that we have had that give us some information about the future. Tells us something about the relationships there. You can look at that at your leisure if you haven't already thought about it. Makes the point that what happened in the United States with regard to GDP decline is also likely to happen in the world. So that takes real data, particularly for the United States, and extrapolates it to the world. Again, gets back to one of my favorite or, well, unfortunate slides on this plateau phenomena with the fluctuations. Again, there's too many words on that. If you're talking and you're presenting this material, a whole lot ought to come from you, I believe, and just the figure and a few words ought to be up there. Again, this is a point that I made and you saw before about the need to add production each year just to stay constant. This basically says that that's what we have done for a significant number of years in spite of the fact that oil prices went up dramatically and so forth. Again, part of a story, there ought to be a lot of words to go with that. This looks at Europe and what actually happened in Europe, real data. They had a plateau production there for something like, I believe, 6 years, and then they went into decline. And that's kind of prototypical of what can happen in the world because we are on a plateau now. That then takes the previous picture and extrapolates it with a question mark of how long, because we don't really know, how long before we get into the onset of decline. Again, a slide that adds to what it is I said before, namely, there's a whole lot of people that are deeply concerned about this problem, and they may say it one way or another, but it's a list of pretty impressive individuals and organizations. Now, these are too many words on a slide, but here are examples of organizations that have talked about the cutback in upstream investment and what that's likely to mean in terms of oil shortages. So here's one set of slide, Morgan Stanley, Barclays, Deutsche Bank, IEA, another. Too many words to present. I mean, you're going to do this, talk to it, and highlight the organizations that have made the point and maybe one or two conclusions. Again, too many words. Even OPEC is saying that this could derail the economy. All right, this just makes the point that we've got two things going on. One is underinvestment, and the other is the geological issues. Gone back and forth with a couple of people on this thing. We don't know the timing on either of them, but the timing on the underinvestment-related oil shortages is going to be relatively soon, because relatively soon we'll come out of this recession that we're in, and, of course, we're eating up production even now, even though production has been cut back. So we've got two different things going on here. Goes back to this picture I made and used before, a number of years in here. This then gets at what you can do about it. Up on top are the administrative things that governments can do, and I think it's important to bring that out. We focused in our 2005 study on the physical mitigation, and yet there's a number of things that can be done. We've thought about these things a great deal ourselves, and these things can help, but they will not solve the problem. And, of course, the biggest thing in all of that is rationing. And rationing sounds relatively easy, but when you dig into it, how you implement it, that is really, really, really difficult. So it's an easy word, but all you have to do is scratch a little bit, and it's very, very complicated. And then we get down to these other issues that we had talked about before, and there again, deployment, absolutely essential. Again, the slide that I showed you before, too many words on this. Don't do that kind of thing. But if it's a handout or a send around, then you can, I think, make an exception. Again, the kind of pictures that I talked about just a minute ago in terms of decline rates and when mitigation takes over and what GDP decline for the world might look like with the assumptions that were developed here. And then conclusions. Tell them what you told them. Okay, now the whole thing that we've talked about up to this point is negative. These are just harsh messages, and people don't like to hear negatives. On the other hand, you're not doing things right if you don't tell them what the realities are. And as hard as it is to swallow, and each one of us had to swallow these things and go through the emotional and mental gyrations that are necessary to understand what's going on here, it's hard. I know personally that as I got into this subject, emotionally, I found it very disturbing for quite some time until I got through the emotional side and got down to just working and doing research and trying to be as factual as possible. Here is something that we use to try to be positive. And the thing here, there's maybe other ways of doing this, is to jump out to 2050. We're going to have a lot of trouble between now and 2050. Maybe it's 2040, but it's not not tomorrow. We're not going to get through this quickly. Good things will have happened by then. So a way to be positive is to get out to that further point in the future and be able to say, we will get through this. We'll be stronger for it. We'll be on a more sustainable path to the future. So that's what this that says. And this emphasizes that a number of these things are going to have to happen in the interim, but then we'll get on to better things. So the conclusion then for training the trainers, and I hope we did reasonably well on time. Oh, well, I can't see it, so I'm told up here, you see. Okay. Basically, this is the kind of thing I've used. These are slides I've used. These are some of the ways I think about some of these slides. There are certainly ways of improving on a number of these messages. There may be better ways of casting the overall message than I have here. You notice I didn't, for instance, spend a whole lot of time talking about something that we're all painfully obviously aware of, and that is that we wouldn't have gotten to this meeting without oil. This room that wouldn't be here without oil, because the chairs were delivered and the carpets were delivered. The building wouldn't be here without oil, because if you look at any construction site, you see materials brought in by oil products, and you see people building things, lifting things, and moving things around and so forth by oil. You can talk about ships and trains and planes and so forth. I haven't tended to to spend a lot of time on those things, but I think it is an important subject, and depending on who you're talking to, I think that that's important. Anyway, that's kind of a quick run-through. It is a fire hose approach to what's involved. Hopefully when you get the paper copy or see this online, you can reflect back on some of these things, and as you see ways to do things better, please do them, and if along the way you've got some thoughts for me, I'd be pleased to hear them. Thank you.